Test.
Hello. Hi, test, test. Yay. Okay. Hi, everybody. Hey. So we're Raid Network, and we're here today to give you an update on our current status and also focusing a little bit on the work that we've been doing towards better usability of the Raid Network. So first of all, who are we? Salut, we are Paul and Franzi. Paul has been a core developer working on the Raid Network since 2017, and I'm working on communications and product since last year, August. So before I dive in, it's always interesting to find out how many people of you already know the Raid Network. Just like do the obligatory show of hands. Oh wow, okay. That's like almost everybody. I will nonetheless do like a quick wrap up of what it is so that you all, you know, are reminded of what we actually do. We are a payment channel network, which means we take transactions off-chain. It's off-chain scaling solution layer 2 for Ethereum. And we enable basically token exchanges to be bidirectional off-chain between counterparties, and it works with any ERC-20 token. Not involving the blockchain obviously has some advantages, and the biggest advantage is actually that you can avoid the bottleneck, the consensus bottleneck, which makes transfers cheaper and faster than on-chain. And we obviously want to have this kind of secured, so the deposit is locked on-chain, always in a payment channel, which means that you can only transfer value off-chain that you have locked within a smart contract on-chain. What happens then off-chain is basically that you send balance proofs with the party that you want to exchange value with back and forth, and these balance proofs you can just imagine like digital checks. So you basically send as many payments back and forth between different counterparties, and at some point you decide, okay, now I want to cash out, and that the net balance of all of the transfers that you have done off-chain gets submitted on-chain, and then you basically can cash out your remaining deposit. That's already quite cool, but obviously it makes much more sense if you cannot only transfer value between the counterparties that you have an open payment channel with, but also with other people that you might not have a deposit on-chain with. And then the network comes into play. So basically, within Raiden, you can transfer anybody in the network a payment when you have a connected path with them, and that's then called mediated payments. Yeah, and we launched our first alpha release, Red Eyes, on the mainnet in December last year. So we've been on mainnet for a little bit more than 2 months, and since then we had also a bug bounty running. So far, no critical bug has been found. If you hadn't had a chance to look at our code, please do so. All of the requirements for the bug bounty are specified at bounty.raiden.network, so feel free to battle test our smart contracts there. And as I said, it's like an alpha release, which means all of the core functionality is already included, but it also comes with some security limitations, which on the one hand is that for the mainnet release, we right now have it limited to a wrapped Ether network, while on the testnet, you can deploy any token network that is ERC-20 compliant, so any token, you can already deploy it on the testnet, but on the mainnet right now it's limited to wrapped Ether. Eventually all of these limits will drop, but for the bug bounty release it's limited to that. And it still comes with all of the features that you would imagine that a token or a payment channel network should have, which means you can basically open channels, you can top them up, you can close them, you can settle them, and you can do those single and multi-hop transfers that I've been talking about. So basically direct payments with people that you have an on-chain deposit with, but also mediated transfers, so multi-hop transfers to other people that are in the network and that you have a channel or a payment path with. And it also comes with an optional feature, which is basically that you can automatically join a token network and you get connected to peers that make sense for the network topology, but that's just an optional feature. And it also obviously comes already with our REST API, which has endpoints for all of the functionalities. Yeah, so looking back, 2018 was very much focused on heads-down development, bringing this baby to mainnet, while 2019 is focused more around really enhancing the usability And that also comes with collecting feedback from the community. So please reach out to us if you have tried it or if you have some comments. And this talk will be focusing a little bit on what we do to increase or enhance the usability. If this clicker still wants to work, no? What do I have to? No? Yeah? I can already say what's on the next slide. So basically, we've been analyzing some of the challenges that we currently see. So challenges that we currently see in terms of adoption and usability. These are not necessarily only limited to challenges for the RAID network, but most of them are really like overall challenges for the whole crypto space or for the whole Ethereum space, and how we plan to improve on the usability and how we plan to tackle those changes. The first one seems to be quite a big hurdle for most of the guys who want to try Raiden. It's basically just running a full node on the Ethereum mainnet. So Raiden basically requires you to have a mainnet node synced and always running and always online. There's just very two straightforward solutions for that. I've stolen this picture from Boris. I hope that's okay. So first solution is just run Ethereum. It's not that hard. There's like many really cool solutions out there. For example, shout out to Dapnode. I see you. It's a really cool software which makes it very easy for you to run any kind of node. And you can either combine that with a digital server setup or even better, obviously, with your own hardware. So that's the one solution which will not only help Raiden, but which will help the whole ecosystem. But also, we've been working or looking into Infura integration. We weren't supporting officially Infura in the beginning because there were some edge cases in which unexpected behavior occurred. However, Infura has now prioritized the remaining like open feature that we needed from on their end on their roadmap. So hopefully, this is going to be solved very soon. And then, Infura is usage is also supported by Raiden. So thanks to Infura. At this point. Second problem, or basically just something that we are continuously working on, is improving the developer experience, which means ultimately what do we want to achieve? We want to make it easy to build scalable applications for developers, and that's why we've been putting a lot of work and effort into our API. Basically, this enables all of you to build something using a payment channel network without needing to know any of the complex details on how a payment channel network actually works. We really try to break it down, and you can find all of the endpoints and a very extensive documentation on how to use them in our docs. Please reach out to us if, for example, an endpoint is missing or something doesn't make sense to you. Please let us know, but this is really meant to make it easy for you to implement Raiden into your application. Then obviously we're doing stuff like sponsoring hackathons, mentoring hackathons, to really spread the word about, on the one hand, how cool payment channel networks are, and on the other hand, also educate if you have some questions and incentivize you to just try it out. We also have hands-on support on Gitter, basically 24/7. If you try out Raiden and you get stuck somewhere, or if you have specific questions on how you can embed Raiden into your own application, then really just reach out to us on Gitter. There's almost all the time one Raiden dev online who can reply to you and help you. And we are also continuously adding support for new platforms. So just very recently in our last release Pluto, we have added ARM binaries, so ARM binaries, which are especially interesting for the IoT community because you can now run Raiden on, for example, a Raspberry Pi, which is quite nice, and we will obviously look into more installation options and platforms to add support to in the future as well. And we just generally try to make testing for applications easier. We have a dedicated team who is basically working on our API, but also on everything that comes like in terms of developer adoption. And they just implemented something called demo nodes, with which you can play, which is nice. And also, we are open sourcing workshop material, and we've already seen like first external guys also hosting Raiden workshops, which was really nice. And yeah, if you have feedback on that, please also let me know. Yeah, and that was like the developer experience side, but we are also looking into the actual user experience side of things. We have a web UI. Oh yeah, okay, so our overall goal is basically to, for the end user, abstract away all kinds of technicalities. I mean, I think all of you in the room know how hard this is. And yeah, we are continuously improving on that to generate this intuitive experience. We have a web UI which continuously improves. We are adding new features. We are also optimizing it for mobile. But this is just really one example of what you can build using our API. And it's not meant to be the only interface. Here you can just see a screenshot. And we just recently added the address book feature and have received nice community feedback on that one. And now we're working on ENS integration there as well. If the video works, I can quickly run you through how it looks like right now. Yeah. So basically, you see two Raiden nodes next to each other. And you see the different screens of the web UI. You have a token network page, where you could see all of the kinds of different token networks that you're part of. You can join new token networks. And you can also directly pay channel partners through that page. Basically, there's a certain kind of steps that you always have to do. You have to specify the token that you want to use. You have to specify the amount and the target address. And there you basically see how a transfer successfully completed. You also have a channel overview page where you can see all of your open channels, where you can open new channels, and where you can deposit tokens in already existing channels. So basically topping up the channel. That's what he's doing there right now, I guess. Yeah, and you can also close channels and pay the channel partners directly on that page. And then we have the third page, which is basically the address book that I just talked about, where, yeah, it seems like a very easy feature, but I think it's improving the usability quite a lot when you can add labels to public keys so that you actually know who you are sending the transfer to. So basically, it's straightforward. You can just specify some sort of name or label for the public key. You can export the whole address book, and you can import address book files. And you can basically edit the stuff. So yeah, I guess that's it for the quick web UI demo. Yeah, and now we're moving over to what we're doing on the development side, so on the back end side, to also improve Raiden's usability. And Paul is doing that for you.
Yeah, thank you, Francie, and welcome. I want to talk about two problems that will help make the ecosystem of Raiden more user-friendly. The first one is pathfinding. So as Franzi already said, like having one payment channel, which is bidirectional, is quite nice. This helps like scaling. You can do off-chain payments, have them a lot faster, a lot quicker. And then obviously the second step, Franzi already said that as well, like we have a network of payment channels. So suddenly that stuff scales on a whole different dimension. And yeah, but that stuff doesn't come for free. Now suddenly other problems pop up, like how do you route this payment through the network? And this is like a problem that we start looking, or that we start improving. So we want to make this pathfinding more efficient. So to see what kind of problems we could run into, let's have a look at this example. And here we have a simple payment with six members, and you see like some channels are open between them. And we have Alice, obviously, who wants to say a payment to Franzi over there. And now, the problem in this payment network is that Alice only knows the exact state of her own channels. I mean, all the stuff, all the payments are done off-chain, so she doesn't know, like, for example, the channel between Dave and Eric, like, what's happening in there, she has no clue. She only knows about the two blue channels. And so she just says, okay, I want to send this payment to Franzi. Let's use the channel to Charlie, and let's see, and hope that Charlie knows a way and mediates the payment forward. So this is done here, and now Charlie's turn, he gets this mediated transfer, and he looks, okay, I have this channel towards Dave, which brings the payment closer to Franzi, and sends it to Dave. So now Dave does the same thing, but Dave finds out, oh, I have this channel to Bob, but actually this channel doesn't have enough capacity in that direction. So actually the amount of the payment is bigger than the capacity of the channel in that direction, so this doesn't work. So obviously Dave looks at the other channels he has open, back to Charlie doesn't make sense, so there's this channel to Eric, and unfortunately Dave tries to ping Eric, but Eric doesn't reply. So nothing to do there. So Dave still wants that payment to be finished, so now it gets backtracked. So the two transfers are kind of reversed and sent back and back at Alice, and we're back at the beginning. And now Alice plays the same game. Okay, there's another channel open to Bob, so let's use that channel to send the payment. That works, and now Bob sees, oh, I have an open channel to Francie, and I can do the payment. Nice, so that worked, but we also saw there's a lot of problems, and you can imagine if the network grows, these problems will become more complicated. How, like if we use this backtracking algorithm without like good knowledge about the channel states, this is gonna end in a big mess and will increase latency of all the payments quite a lot. So what we do instead is like creating a pathfinding service, and this service will have like better knowledge or knowledge about the channel balances, as well later about the mediation fees for each of the channels, and it will also know about the presence or the online state of the different nodes in the network. And this will make it possible to create way better routes and make the whole system way more efficient. So to look how that works technically, let's go back to the example between Dave and Bob, and Dave sent like a big payment over to Bob. And that destroys capacity in the direction towards Bob. And now Dave sends this information, okay, there has been a big change in my channel, towards the pathfinding service. And the pathfinding service like acknowledges that and says like, okay, I'm gonna put that into my routing information for later usage. In the other example with Eric, the PFS like pings people or knows about their challenge and also incorporates that information into its routing information and bases like the routing calculations on that. So now in this like updated system with the pathfinding service, Alice wouldn't just start like sending the payment with the with the best channel as she thinks, but she would actually send like a routing request to the pathfinding service, which would be something like, okay, listen, I want to send a payment with that amount towards Francie. Can you give me some routes? And then the pathfinding service looks through all the routing information it has available, sends like a couple of routes which it thinks are cheapest and like working in the current network conditions, and will that send that back to Alice to be usable. And yeah, obviously the PFS won't make that for free, so Alice will also pay a small fee to make the whole system economically viable. Yes, that was the pathfinding problem. And now for maybe more serious problem, as Franzi already said, our initial mainnet release was called Red Eyes, and that wasn't without a reason. So basically, at the moment, a Raiden client has to stay online because otherwise people could close channels. And once a channel closes, you have to be able to react, because you have to send in your part of the receipts that Francie talks about. Otherwise, you might lose some tokens. And we are tackling that problem, and it's a known problem with like Lightning on Bitcoin as well. And yeah, let's look again at Alice and Bob. They have a channel here again, and they send this balance proof that Francie already talked about between each other, and everything is fine. But suddenly, Alice has this need to go offline, and she needs to shut down her Raiden node, but she doesn't want to close this channel exactly, because you know that takes some time and it costs on-chain transactions, so it's actually, she plans to come online later again. So what she does now with these monitoring services, she actually sends them a request for monitoring. And this monitoring request includes all the information that are needed to update the on-chain channel information. So everything that Alice would do can be done by the monitoring services, and it also includes a reward for the monitoring services to actually make them do that. I mean, otherwise they wouldn't have any incentive to do that. So then Alice is now offline, as we see, and Bob somehow finds out about it and tries to capitalize on that. So, yeah, we see he sends the balance proof he received from Alice towards the token network on-chain and closes this channel. And now it's Alice's turn to react, because otherwise just Bob claimed some tokens, but Alice didn't do anything. So would be bad for her, but luckily she sent this balance proof she received to the monitoring services. And the monitoring services find out about that. They see, okay, this channel got closed. Do I have something in my database that I have to react to? And yeah, they instead act on behalf of Alice, and everything turns out fine. And Bob can only close the channel when he uses the correct balances. And yeah, obviously, as I said, this monitoring request includes information about the reward, and the monitoring services are free to decide if that's enough for them. And the monitoring service that actually sent the on-chain update is then able to collect the reward that Alice provided for him. So people who are have read a bit about all these monitoring services, or for Lightning it's called watchtowers, know that it's a really big design space of possible solutions. So you might wonder, why doesn't Alice get something back from the monitoring services, okay, I'm watching your channel or something like that. And we watched at that, and one of the famous papers is the PISA paper for people that might be interested or have read it already. And we decided to go with the simplest solution that we could see and collect feedback. We think there's a lot of things that might be nice to have, but we build a simple solution now, and then we can improve. If people say, okay, it would be nice to get this certificate of monitoring, then we can build it later. And also, we think there's way for multiple different implementations in the network. I mean, different people might have different priorities, so it's always nice if it doesn't have to be us, but other third parties decide, okay, I implement a different solution, I choose different trade-offs, so that's totally possible with the current Raiden network. Yeah, so that's our small update on Raiden. Thank you very much for listening. Here's a link to the download page of Raiden. We would urge everyone to try it out. A lot of feedback we get is that it's actually easier than expected. Also, we have a booth outside where you can try Raiden on mainnet live without having to open your own channels. But if you want that, you can get some nice merchandise from us. Really limited, so be quick. Thanks for listening again, and let's keep in touch. And if there's any questions, come to our booth, and then we can clarify. Thank you.